Hello, everybody, and welcome to B-Movie Euphoria. I am Nick, and with us today, we have, yet again, the great Josh Spanninga.
Hello.
Josh Spanninga and I are doing another I.R.S. media, the Films of I.R.S. media review. I.R.S. media came from this record company called I.R.S., which stood for International Record Syndicate, which was started by Miles Copeland III, and they were really popular in the 80s. But then eventually, you know, the 80s were kind of winding down, and Miles decided to start a production company called I.R.S. Media, and they made roughly around 30-ish movies. And our goal is to find all of those movies. And today we are talking about a little film called, let me find my copy, called Circuitry Man.
It is a race against time. Against the guardians of the underworld.
So I want to ride out of here.
No room for passengers.
Against the ravagers of the deserts.
Get them!
Against the one man who cannot be stopped. But must be destroyed.
Head rush!
It's not the chips that I want. It's always been you. Welcome to my mind.
Circuitry Man.
I was a little nervous going into it just because while I enjoyed A Sinful Life. While I enjoyed that film, I mean, it was okay. Circuitry Man, though, I saw that it was going to be more of like action-y, suspense, maybe a little bit of horror in there, sci-fi, all that. Mm-hmm. So I was like, oh, are they going to be able to pull it off? And I think they do. You can tell it's a low-budget film.
I can feel it.
I will say there are also points where I kind of forgot. I just got so swept up in it that I was just like, I don't even care, which is the best kind of low budget film. The character of Plughead.
Oh my God.
Into that. That's first off. I mean, he's right on the cover.
Yes.
That's, of course. I mean, that's clearly the selling point of the movie.
The cover of both one and two.
Yeah. So he's Plughead. He's the villain of the film.
Do you like bald-headed guys?
I just loved his presence. It was really very good.
Like a little bit. So the whole movie is a little bit kinky. The whole movie is a little bit like sexually charged in a weird way. And his performance, like you were saying, is very just bizarre and like sexual.
Yeah, I couldn't quite pin him other than he made me feel gross and I didn't like him, but I do like him because he's so fascinating. This movie's kind of hinging on having a villain that you can really hate but also enjoy watching, and I think they nailed that for sure.
It's just so interesting. The movie really kind of drops you into this world.
40 years after the ocean died, and the last tree fell in the last rainforest, the air became unbreathable. Mankind moved underground into government-controlled environments. There, they continued to ravage the last frontier, the human mind.
The mind!
Yeah. So that's what, like, before you see any images of any people or anything, that's like, you see that along.
And so right off the bat, you're confused.
Yeah.
How are people eating? I guess they could we find out later there's some like interesting animals, like the leeches.
Yes. Yes, toxic leeches. But yeah, I know, I thought that too. And the trees too. I was like,
and the trees are dead, so where's the air coming from?
Yeah, and it actually made me think of a really profound question, that was if the last tree in the last rainforest fell,
yeah,
it wouldn't technically be a forest, it would just be a single tree. Like, when does it turn from being a rainforest into just, this is the last rain tree? Like, I didn't...
Yeah, it's just one rain tree by itself. It starts out with Lori, our hero, the heavy, kind of like the tough guy of the movie. Dana Wheeler-Nicholson is the actress, and she's tied to a bed, and she is having a makeout session with some guy, and it's really bad. It's a bad makeout. It doesn't look good at all. Honestly, all of the kissing in this movie is bad.
You're right. There's no chemistry between any of them, but it works.
It's fine. It does work in the
movie. It's fine. It does. You get the idea.
So this guy is making out with her, and then she's like, "Do you love me?" And then he's just like, "No, I don't." And then he walks away, and she's like, "What the fuck?" And she's, you know, tied to the thing. And then we get Juice, who's the main kind of mob boss. We get her henchman, whose name is Yo-Yo. And Yo-Yo is one of my favorite characters from the movie.
Okay.
So Yo-Yo is a goon, but she also has two goons. Mm-hmm. You know, she has two, like, guys. And one that she is incredibly sexual with.
At this point, too, I was kind of wondering, like, how many bodyguards do people need? Or, like, is that just,
so
like,
many bodyguards?
The main profession for most people? Like, there's... Because they used... She used bodyguards to then almost kidnap Lori.
Right.
To then make her a bodyguard for...
Yeah, you already got bodyguards. You need another bodyguard to protect you from... Like, what is happening? Yo-Yo shows up and basically tells Lori, like, we need you for this job, and you know, you used to be the best. And Lori kind of gets out of her being tied up, and she punches one guy and socks another dude, and then agrees to it anyway. So it doesn't even matter. It's just a weird job interview to start off with. Basically, they got someone to seduce her just so they could be like, hey, do you want this job?
I did want to mention, because you brought up the one Yo-Yo is very sexual with one of the, like, that scene in the elevator
very surprised me.
You designed those threads?
Yeah. You like them?
Fuck no. I'm a woman of taste. You look like shit.
So we got Juice, Lori, Yo-Yo, and one of her goons are riding the elevator up. Mm-hmm. And then you see, since they're in the back, Yo-Yo and the goon are just like, and you see the hand go into the goon's pants.
Yeah.
And then you see him go, oh, yeah. And this is all happening in this elevator.
Well, and I think in this movie, all of the sexual stuff just feels so inappropriate, and like, this should not be happening right now. Like, it does not make...
Yes, that is the rule of the movie. It's like, whenever there is no place for a sexual moment, that's when they put it in the movie. We're going to this fancy nightclub or whatever, and we first see Plughead in silhouette. We see him like behind a shade, wearing a fancy hat.
What was his backstory? He was Juice's psychoanalyst?
Yeah, we get a very, very quick backstory of Plughead.
He used to be Juice's psychotherapist before he became a legitimate crook.
Yeah, and that, so basically he's a psychotherapist that kind of got addicted to jacking in, I think.
Yes.
For the most part.
Ravaging the human mind portion.
This is not something that the movie tells us, but this is something that I assumed through watching the movie, in that most humans have a jackpot in their head.
Mm-hmm.
And at least one. And humans are now addicted to basically jacking on and, you know, doing computer chip drugs. And so that's once we finally meet Plughead and we have this little meeting mm-hmm. between Plughead and Juice with Lori and Yo-Yo backing her up. They are doing a deal to sell a suitcase full of these drug chips.
It's just effective, and it's just all because of his facial expressions and his groans and moans of pleasure.
Oh, yeah. He's such a sexual beast. Of course, during the drug deal, like you were saying, Danner shows up, and Danner is super pissed off at Juice because he thinks Juice knows where his long-lost love is. Even though she doesn't exist, because obviously Juice just made it a program in his head. And so he just comes into the meeting. He's like, I swear I'll kill myself. And he puts a corkscrew to his neck and everybody just starts laughing because no one cares.
Yeah.
Which is kind of great because it kind of gets us into this really cynical and terrible world. But you also get a window into Danner, who's kind of like, you're right. I really do love Jim Metzler is the actor. I really love the performance because it's like, he's clearly not human, but he envelops all the best qualities of a human being. Like the joy and the love and caring and devotion and all of that. And so I really love how almost childlike his just demand to have his love back, and it's almost like fairy tale, you know.
Well, and his appearance too. He's he's wearing like the puffy shirt and like his hair, and he looks like he belongs on a romance novel cover.
Exactly,
which makes sense because he is what do they refer to? He's a fully synthetic pleasure. Is he?
Pleasure droid. And then finally the meeting is broke up because we got a couple undercover cops mm-hmm. and they're like, all right, nobody move.
Which I thought was great because it was the undercover cops were literally like the two random people that were there. Like,
yeah, they were with no one.
Why are you there to begin with? And there's a lot of commotion.
Yeah.
And I don't know. The next part that fully jumps to my mind is when Plughead confronts Juice.
So he goes to Juice and basically just his presence is freaking her out so much. She's just like, oh, have the chips. It's fine. You can just take them. I don't care. And then he's like, okay, thanks. And he's walking off. And then Juice has to say something. And you always see this in movies where you're just like, you know, you would have been good. You could have just walked away. But then Juice is like, you better watch your back too. And then he just comes back and he's just like,
I hated you for that.
For such a big woman, you break so very easily.
Next.
Relax, sweet mate. This will be a snap.
She stabs him. She gets the chips, and then she jets off. And then, for the rest of the movie, it's a fucking road movie.
Yes, basically. And I forgot how cool the mechanic was. He is also a favorite character. He's not in it for very long, but he does come back a couple of times. But yeah, he's like he felt like something out of a manga. like
he was Iron Man, basically.
He's like a junkyard mechanic that just was like this crane. He just moved around the whole shop on the crane.
I'm gonna shock you right now.
What's up?
You know who that actor is?
Who?
The actor who played the machine guy.
Okay.
Okay, so you know a little movie called Eating Raoul? As soon as I saw him, I was like, I know him. I know that nose. And he is the very first victim in Eating Raoul. He's the sleazy swinger guy.
Okay.
Lori convinces Danner, just with a little bit of convincing, not too much at all, to go with her on this quest to New York, basically.
Yep.
Is their destination.
Sell the chips?
Yes, or... to sell the chips and to make money. And she does it in a really sleazy way, which is, you know, I'll show you where your love is. I'll show you where the love of your life is.
Yeah.
And so before they go on this road trip, they head to this mechanic's place. He is a guy that's just squished into this giant piece of machinery, and he's moving himself around via this, I don't know, torque system that lifts him up and down. And he's really nice and gives them a car, basically. And then he gets his fucking brain drained for his troubles. At one point, like, after Plughead comes and gets the information that he needs, then the cops come and they vacuum his brain out of his head.
Oh, yeah, that's
right. For the rest of the information. Meanwhile, Lori and Danner are driving around, which looks like just an endless series of, like, parking garages. Mm-hmm. Just, like, the basement of 1,000 parking garages.
Yeah.
And I guess that's the maze that they're going through, even though there's not, doesn't really seem like much of a maze. But they're driving, and they're driving, and then we finally meet up with... one of my least liked characters in the movie, and that's Leech.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm normally drawn to characters like Leech, but I don't know what it was about. I can't put my finger on it, but I did not find him likable.
No. He wasn't likable in the normal sense, where he was constantly fucking over everybody.
Mm-hmm.
But he was also not likable because he has this terrible New Jersey accent, which he's just, like, milking.
Oh, my God.
Don't touch him. There's nothing you can do for him now. He's full of toxins.
They hit a spot where toxic leeches are falling from the ceiling, and they're like, we got to get out of the car, and they're running, and then Leech shows up with a flamethrower to, like, burn off the leeches, and we learn that, like, he knows the way out of there and whatever. I just didn't like him at all. He was so, like, aggressively unlikable. Oh, when he eats that leech, like, he has this whole little speech about, like, now look at this leech. If I ate it right now, I'd get sick for days. But if I put it in a boiling pot of water, I could eat it for weeks. But then he eats it. And I'm like, you just said if you eat it now, you're going to get violently ill.
I was thinking the same thing. I didn't, maybe because he didn't eat the whole thing. I don't know. But
yeah, what the?
It looked like mushed up pickled bologna. And it was so gross.
That actor, Dennis Christopher, was also in A Sinful Life as Mr. Nathan Flowers, the Christian...
Sears?
Yes.
Sears robot manager?
Sears robot guy. They shoot out of the underground lair, or the underground world, which, yet again, their escape from... this underground shelter makes no sense, because they're driving in this, like I said, endless series of parking garages, And then finally they're just like, oh yeah, there's a wall there. And I think it's Leech that's like, no, no, go through it. And they're like, no, no, it's a wall. And they're like, nah, it's not a wall. Forget about it. And then like they just drive through the wall, and then it's just they're in the world now.
It's kind of like Mario Brothers.
Yes.
Mario Brothers movie a lot. Just like through the wall, and then all of a sudden you're topside.
They're driving. The car they're driving, I think, has oxygen coming into it so they can breathe.
Yes.
As long as the top's up.
The car is running on oxygen, I believe. They said they get like 800 some miles to the gallon or something.
Oh, that's fantastic.
It was crazy. Yeah, yeah.
We get to this bar, and immediately the waitress is hitting on Danner. Lori kind of disappears for a while, but Danner notices that there's like a scuffle happening over by the pool table. Mm-hmm. And a couple of the tough guys basically shove another one of the guys out the door and then turn off the air. And so Danner decides that he needs to save this guy, and he just opens the door and lets the guy back in. And then that starts with the biggest guy in the bar, like, you fucking assholes. And that so Danner gets shoved into that room, and he stops being able to breathe, even though he's an android or biomechanical.
He's a fully synthetic android. Oh, okay. So my understanding was that like he still worked like a human, like he still had to breathe and stuff.
So Lori will hit the button so he has air, and then you'll just see Danner in the booth, like watching from outside and just hearing all this commotion and people getting beat up or whatever. And then a knife will stick in the button and he'll lose air again. And you'll hear more fighting and like a chair thrown against the wall, and then somebody else will press the button. He'll have air again.
I felt like that scene was at least really well choreographed.
It was, and it was smart in the sense that they didn't have to film a fight scene.
No. It was literally just people like throwing stuff or slamming stuff against the button. Yeah.
That's all you need. I mean, you get the idea. And so the conclusion to this fight is that the biggest guy who started the fight smashes the window to the door and is like, forget it. You guys are cool. Whatever. And then Leech, they're like, hey, your guy outside's trying to signal you. And they look outside and it's fucking Leech. And he goes, fuck you. See ya. Bye. And he just takes off. But then the biggest, meanest guy at the bar is like, oh, yeah, I'll give you a ride. Okay, all right. And then
I think it's just a world where you have to prove how tough. It's like some sort of world where you have to prove how tough you are before people will trust you. And then if you can handle them in a fight, then it's like, okay, you got my respect.
So Danner and Lori kind of fall for each other throughout this whole road tripping thing. She's constantly giving him shit, like whenever he gets really sappy with her, he's like, she's basically like, all right, don't pull any of your Romeo shit on me, like I don't have any money to pay you, so don't give me this like sappy crap, I don't care. And I loved that too. That made me so happy. They all get captured, I think, and then that's when we have the guy that gave them a ride. He's all tied up to be drawn and quartered.
Yes.
By Plug.
That was my favorite scene of the whole film.
That scene?
It was horrible, but that was the scene. So we're talking about the drawn and quartered portion now, right? Okay. Yep. So I really liked that because it turned like full Hellraiser. Like Plughead turned into a Cenobite pretty much. Because he wanted this guy to die in a horrible, painful way, and he wanted to be jacked into the guy's mind to experience it while he experienced being killed.
Make a wish.
Oh, I need to feel the pain!
then Danner is tied up, mm-hmm. and instead of drawing and quartering him, Plughead thinks it's an even worse torture to plug into him and let him know that the woman that he's in love with, his long lost love,
mm-hmm.
doesn't exist and never did.
I really like the visuals used in this portion too, because it's like you're seeing the memory and it's flashing like do you feel like it was like shot on video?
That's what I thought, the tracking thing to it.
Yeah, the editing and tracking is like you're watching, yeah, video footage of scenes from earlier in the film, but from the character's point of view. So it's the scene where Juice is explaining to Laurie that the woman Danner is chasing doesn't even exist. It's just right. a program.
He leaves him with, he just throws a knife in the dirt, and then he's just like, why don't you do what you've been threatening for the whole fucking movie? Just fucking do yourself in. And then I think I'm pretty sure he gets Laurie. God, the whole end is jumbled to me because everything just comes together in yet another abandoned warehouse. Basically, there's a huge conflict at the end where we have Juice coming back. Surprise! We have Plughead, we have the cops, we have Laurie and Danner, we've got Leech and Yo-Yo. Everybody comes together in the end. But I kind of want to get to the very end where it's the fight off between Danner and Plughead. And Plughead jacks into Danner, and they are immediately warped into this, you know, 90s internet, basically.
Yeah, and that is, I guess, you're right, that is the portion where it becomes more Hellraiser, hellscape-y. Face is just so much like latex and like crazy prosthetics. And
you see their feet like walking and just walking on piles and piles of human bodies. And then they just have this confrontation together, and it's awesome.
You know what? It actually, another thing it reminded me of a bit was Ken Russell's Altered States.
Oh, yeah.
The like apocalyptic biblical imagery in that it was done in a similar way as this scene in Circuitry Man with like the whole piles of bodies and flames.
In that whole scene, Plughead calls Danner Circuitry Man. You're like, oh, there's the title.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole time I was like, oh, I thought Plughead was security.
He is. He is a circuitry man too.
He is. Yes. He is also.
They're both circuitry men.
And they're that's both. What they know, each none other. Is better than the other. They're both equal circuitry men. Okay. They're just. Yeah. They're just different. One likes to fuck and be romantic, and the other one just likes to feel the pain of someone being torn apart.
So Plughead throughout the movie is talking about like how he likes to jack in with his plugs and stuff.
Yeah.
And as if they didn't already make it sound sexual enough, he has to just explicitly say, why jack off when you can jack in towards the end of the movie. And yeah, I felt that was a little unnecessary, but
It
drove the point home.
That just reminded me of another one where Danner's like tied up to be drawn and quartered. And this is the first time Plughead like jacks into him, and he goes, what? Only one hole?
How boring.
But before we do our each of our, you know, our thoughts on it, I want to get into the IRS part of this
movie. Yes. Yes, please. Because I didn't do any research. So
I did a little bit of research. Okay. So there's only like two or three songs in this movie, and they're all done by the same person. So the singer Deborah Holland did that. So there's this jazzy score going throughout the entire movie. And she actually shows up in the movie, too, when they get to the fancy nightclub. On a corner, never waiting for much. I was minding my own business when I felt some stranger's touch. So she did all the songs for the movie, and her IRS connection is she back in the 80s, she founded a band called Animal Logic with Stuart Copeland, who is the brother of Miles Copeland, and also the original drummer for The Police. So she started this band, Animal Logic. It was put out by IRS Records, and they made multiple IRS records with Animal Logic. But yeah, so Deborah Holland did like three songs for this movie. She also went on to do music for five more IRS movies. In general, I'm going to say this is going to be my review of the movie. I 100% recommend people see this. And I think it's fun. I think it's a great, weird version of the future. I love visions of the future. It was written and directed by brothers, Stephen and Robert Lovey, who also made the sequel, and then they made nothing else.
Huh.
This was at the time when IRS was just kind of like plucking scripts from, you know, wherever they were floating around in Hollywood, and they're like, yep, that's the one. We're going to make that movie. And I'm really glad that they took the chance on this weird, bizarre, futuristic movie, because it's kind of fantastic, I got to say. Yeah,
I really enjoyed it quite a bit. I like I said, kind of in the beginning, I wasn't expecting too much. I was just like, you know, I don't want to get my hopes up. And I know it's a low budget and everything, but they really worked well with low budget, kind of just a mindless movie. You don't have to really fully understand what's going on at what point. You can just sit back and whatever's up on the screen is super entertaining.
That's a really good point, because it's like, it's exactly that. It's one of those movies that you can just turn your brain off and enjoy.
With your lips now.
So this is the third movie to come out from IRS. So we're doing it pretty much in order.
Okay.
And now I'm just excited because it's kind of a quite a few years between these two. So IRS was doing pretty great in these years, and then not so great in these years.
Okay. So far with the IRS films I've seen, they're the type of films where, yeah, even the gripes that I have with it, it's like, it's not that big of a deal. Or it's, you know, I might not like this or that about it, but at least it's interesting, and it's making me feel something.
There's inspiration to it. Yes. There's true, like, these people are so happy to be making a movie that they are just going to put every inch of themselves into this movie. And you can really tell that, as opposed to a movie like, I just saw Bullet Train recently, and it's a really entertaining movie. Mm-hmm. It's fun, and there's a lot going on, but at the same time, it just feels like a factory product.
This feels more like a group of, small group of people. They're just like, wouldn't it be real fucked up if instead of taking drugs, you can just like plug in and experience things in the future?
For being a shitty B movie, it's pretty prophetic as far as what's actually going on in the world.
Yeah, I mean, if Elon Musk gets his way.
Oh my God, this is Elon Musk.
Honestly, honestly, I did think of that though, with like Neuralink and all of that.
Yes.
Like, kind of. You're right, it kind of isn't far off.
Oh my God, that's terrifying. So yeah, watch it because it's not far off. Watch it because it's fun as hell. Thank you so much, Josh. We have less than a minute to talk, so let's thank you everybody for watching the Films of IRS Media. Thank you, Josh Spanninga, for yet again joining us for this journey. We are going to find all those IRS films.
Thank you for having me, and I am ready for more.
Yeah! All right. I love you, buddy. I'll see you soon.
See ya. It was great talking.
I don't know why I'm afraid of you.